Hello, and welcome to episode 13 of Unpacking Articles. The article we're going to unpack today is written by a colleague whose research interests are closely aligned with my own, and that is collaborative writing tasks in the L2 classroom, comparing group, pair, and individual work. As the title implies, the article addresses a practical aspect of learner interaction, which is the number of participants. Is it better to put students in pairs or in small groups? Or is it better for them to work by themselves? A concept that is central to understanding the findings of this study is language-related episodes, which sometimes are called form-focused episodes. And these are instances where the interlocutors turn their attention to language itself, for example, vocab, grammar, etc., and they work together to solve their linguistic dilemmas. Presumably, these episodes are facilitative of language development because it helps learners consolidate their knowledge or get new knowledge. So, for example, if they don't know how to say something, their partner might provide them with that form, or if they're not sure if something is right, their partner might be able to confirm the hypotheses that they are testing. Previous research has compared pairs and individuals, and the general trend is that when learners work in pairs, they tend to produce more accurate text than if they work by themselves. But there isn't a clear indication that pairs focus more on form, that they have more of these language-related episodes than individuals. And this has been measured using think-alouds, where the learners are working by themselves, but they verbalize what they're thinking while they're writing. And so what that tells us is that in terms of resolution of the linguistic dilemmas, having someone else as a resource, if you will, is helpful. And so it's natural to wonder, would groups be better because there's more resources? And that's what the current study we're unpacking is trying to find out. The participants were 111 intermediate level students of Spanish. They were in a second year course, and the data collection took place during regular class time. Different sections of the same course were assigned different treatment conditions. So some students were told to work individually, others worked in pairs, and others worked in groups of four. The task consisted of writing a story based on pictures, and the interaction of students who worked in pairs and groups was recorded. The language-related episodes that occurred in the recorded interactions were coded according to their focus and the resolution. So whether the students were discussing something related to vocab, related to grammar, or related to mechanics like spelling. And in terms of resolution, whether it was correctly resolved, unresolved, or incorrectly resolved. In the written text, the stories that the learners wrote were coded for accuracy, fluency, and complexity. And this is a pretty standard way of coding written samples. There are many ways of measuring these three things, and I'm going to simplify things. And I'll say that accuracy is related to number of errors, fluency is related to number of words, and complexity is related to number of clauses. Now let's look at the results for the written samples first. In terms of accuracy, groups did better than everybody else, and pairs and individuals did about the same. In terms of fluency, number of words, students working by themselves individually, they wrote more than everyone else. And in terms of complexity, everybody did about the same. So there were no differences in terms of complexity. With respect to the language-related episodes within the interaction of pairs and groups, they occurred more often in groups than in pairs, on average. In terms of resolution of these episodes, these dilemmas, the groups were able to correctly resolve these LREs more frequently than pairs. And in terms of what were they discussing, everybody, both groups and pairs, discussed grammar and vocab at about the same rate. And with respect to mechanics, a little more in the groups than in pairs, but overall they were fairly infrequent. And so the bottom line appears to be the more the merrier, or at least the more accurate. But as we have hinted at in previous episodes, there is the famous or infamous trade-off of fluency versus accuracy. So you get more words and less accuracy, or you get more accuracy and fewer words. We saw in this particular study that the students who worked by themselves wrote more, but they were less accurate. Now, the question that arises, and this study doesn't necessarily address it, is that because they took more risks or because they had fewer resources? And then there's another trade-off that the author alludes to in this quote. Although group work offered fewer opportunities for individual participation, it had a positive impact on collaborative dialogue. And so you have this trade-off between negotiation, collaboration, interaction, and individual accountability. Of course, when the students are working just by themselves or just with one other learner, there is more accountability at the individual level. The more members a group has, the more that gets diluted or distributed across members of the group. So some of the limitations of the study are more of a wish list of things that I think future research should look at. First, one thing that may have, and the operative word be may have influenced the results is the lack of verbalization on the part of the students who worked alone. What if they were told to think aloud while writing? Could that have also affected their fluency and accuracy? Of course, I think it's great that the author kept it as real as possible. In our classrooms, it's probably not feasible to have 20 students thinking aloud at the same time. So without a doubt, working in silence by themselves reflects the reality of classrooms. I still think that the influence of thinking aloud is a possibility that should be considered in the future. Second, it's unclear who helped whom or who benefited from the interaction. In some groups, some students were more observers than active participants, and so could that be a drawback of small groups? Or are the observers still benefiting from observing the interaction that is happening between other members of the group? And the reason why we don't know from this study alone is that there were no post-treatment measures. And on that note, we don't know if the students retained any of the information shared by their classmates, either in pairs or in small groups. Other interaction studies do include post-treatment measures, usually in the form of what's called tailor-made post-test, where the learners are asked to see if they remember those words or those forms that their classmates shared with them. And last but not least, I earlier said the more the merrier, we don't really know if they were truly merry. Language-related episodes can only give us one part of the picture, but it doesn't give us the complete picture of learner interaction. We have to take into account peer perceptions as well as perceptions towards the task itself. Why? Because just looking at the data of negotiation episodes, it might look like groups did great because there were so many negotiation episodes, but we don't know how the learners felt towards that collaboration. It could be that they felt resistant to accepting each other's suggestions. And in that case, can we really say that there was a whole lot of learning going on? And so the takeaway is, why not both? As is the case with many aspects of language, but writing in particular, there are individual and collaborative layers to it. And so this is definitely a case where, once again, it's not about either or. And not just in terms of a variety of activity formats in a lesson, but rather within an activity itself. I think it's important to make room for both. And that way we get the best of both worlds, so to speak. We have the individual accountability piece, but we also have the benefits of collaborative learning. That's just my take on it. As usual, I encourage you to read the original and draw your own conclusions. Thank you for tuning in, and until next time.